Welcome to the Ascent of Mount Carmel YouTube channel. This is where we discuss the book, Ascent of Mount Carmel by St. John of the Cross. Before we begin discussing the book, let's take a closer look at who the author was. It will probably help us to understand the book a little bit better, and certainly it'll help us understand St. John of the Cross better. As we go through the book, some viewers might think, well, this seems to be out of the ordinary, and perhaps they might think St. John of the Cross is out of the mainstream of Catholicism. Well, John is one of the 35 doctors of the Catholic Church. He is, of course, canonized. He is quoted in the Catechism of the Catholic Church multiple times. Nonetheless, John of the Cross is no doubt countercultural. This is an era where people seek comfort above all else. So who was St. John of the Cross? Well, he is considered one of the foremost poets of the Spanish language. He was also a mystic. Along with St. Teresa of Avila, he helped to found the Order of the Descalced, meaning barefoot Carmelites. For this, he was persecuted and he suffered very much. But great good didn't come from evil. Perhaps Ascent of Mount Carmel was the outgrowth of some of the persecution that John had to endure. If you've ever asked yourself the question, or asked someone else, why do good people suffer? Well, please do read this book, Ascent of Mount Carmel. I suspect by the time you've completed about 40 pages or so, you'll never ask that question again. So please do read the book. Please do subscribe to this YouTube channel. St. John of the Cross was born in Spain in 1542, and he lived in Spain all his life. His father was named Gonzalo, and he was born into a wealthy family. And by trade, he was an accountant to his rich relatives, who mostly were silk merchants. The story of Gonzalo and his wife is actually a love story. Before Gonzalo married his wife, his family threatened to disown him, and that was because she was of a lower class. Yet he went ahead and married her, and he was forced to give up his occupation because his family did in fact disown him, and he became a weaver along with his wife. Now they were very poor, but John's parents did the best they could to provide him. However, the situation went from bad to worse, because within 7 years after John was born, Gonzalo died, leaving the family destitute. John's mother did the best that she could to provide for her family. John's brother, Luis, died about 2 years after the death of Gonzalo, probably of malnutrition. John himself suffered from malnutrition as a child, and later St. Teresa of Avila would lovingly refer to him as a half a fry because his growth had been stunted as a child. John was sent to a school for poor children, and he showed himself to be a very good student. And when he became of age, he was apprenticed out to a craftsman, which was the normal course of things. However, in that type of occupation, John actually seemed incapable of learning anything. But fortunately, the governor of a hospital in the area took him into his service. And for 7 years, John served the poorest of the poor and the sick, and also attending a Jesuit school. John was very religious all his life. And when he became of age, he entered the Carmelite order, taking the name of John of St. Matthias. He studied theology and philosophy at the prestigious University of Salamanca, and he was ordained a priest in 1567. When he was in Medina, he met the Carmelite nun, Teresa of Jesus, and she talked to him about her plans for reforming the Carmelite order. She sought to restore the purity of the order by restoring the primitive rule that had originally been observed by the order, but it was relaxed by Pope Eugene IV and other popes. Under the primitive order, much of the day and night was spent reciting the choir offices, studying religious writings and celebrating the Mass, and spending time in silence and solitude. Time was also spent evangelizing the lay people in the area around the monastery. Under the rule, there was a total abstinence from meat, and there was fasting from September 14th all the way until Easter. Descalced Carmelites wore coarser, shorter habits, and of course, they wore no shoes. John and Teresa also spent much time discussing mystical theology, and witnesses said that as they talked, there was an iron grate which would separate them because they were man and woman. And as they discussed mystical theology, witnesses said that as they talked, they entered into a religious ecstasy, and they levitated. They had to hold on to the height in order to anchor themselves. After spending time with Teresa, John left to found a new monastery for friars. Now, they moved into a dilapidated house that had been donated to Teresa, and on the day the monastery was established, John took a new name, John of the Cross. He set up a couple more religious communities for men, but then Teresa invited him to Avila, where he became the spiritual director of the convent for Teresa and about 130 nuns, as well as for many lay people in the city. While in that city, John had a vision of a crucified cross, which inspired him to sketch his famous drawing, Christ from Above. This drawing was placed in a monstrance in Avila, and it was saved and became well known. And in 1951, Salvador Dali did his famous painting, Christ of St. John of the Cross, which we use in our introduction to the Ascent of Mount Carmel channel. The reforms of Teresa and John met with a great deal of resentment from most of the Carmelite order. The greater part of the Carmelites were called Calced Carmelites, meaning they wore shoes. In short, the issue was that the Calced Carmelites felt that the Discalced Carmelites were making them look bad because of their seemingly more severe practices. As a result, the General Chapter of the Carmelite Order was convened in Italy. They decided that the changes of the Discalced Carmelites were getting out of hand, so they ordered the suppression of the group. Shortly afterwards, John was arrested in Medina del Campo by some Carmelite friars. However, through the intervention of others, he was quickly released. About 1 year later, a group of Carmelites opposed to the reform broke into John's house in Avila. They grabbed him, they took him prisoner, and they dragged him off from Avila to a Carmelite monastery in Toledo. They held what was basically a kangaroo court, and they charged John with disobedience. And he was jailed in a monastery, held in secret, where he, at least once a week, they beat the heck out of him. And all the while, the righteous Calced Carmelites were looking on. They locked John away in a solitary confinement. He was held in a tiny, stifling cell, and he was rarely even given a lamp. So he had to stand on a bench to read his prayers, his Bible, by the light through a small hole in the adjoining room. He was, in effect, held in darkness. Perhaps this is where Dark Night of the Soul came from. He was never given a change of clothing. He wasted away while the only food that they gave him was bread, water, and just scraps of fish. As we noted earlier, great good can come from bad. Great good can come from suffering. While being deprived of sensory comfort and being kept in darkness, John wrote his poem, Dark Night of the Soul, which we'll talk about more in the next installment on this channel. It's a poem that describes the journey of a soul from its bodily home into union with God. And most of John's greatest poetry was written either at that time or shortly thereafter. After 9 long months of weekly beatings, of food barely enough to survive, John managed to pry his cell door off its hinges. While he left that door in place during the day, but at night, he then moved the door, went into that adjoining room with that small window, and just managed to crawl through that tiny window and made his escape. He headed back to Avila, where the nuns of St. Teresa nursed him back to health. With no malice in his heart, he went straight back to work, working on the reforms of the Discalced Carmelites. Now, a meeting of the Discalced Carmelites was held, and it was realized that they were really pushing a very large boulder up a hill, and maybe it made more sense just to start a new order. So they petitioned for a pope to separate them from the Calced Carmelites. In June of 1580, Pope Gregory XIII authorized the formal separation between the Calced and Discalced Carmelites. Now, a couple of years after escaping the jail of the monastery, John set about writing his book, Ascent of Mount Carmel, which actually is a lengthy explanation of the poem, Dark Night of the Soul. Now, Ascent of Mount Carmel was originally planned to be 4 books, and it only ended up being 3 books, so it only leaves us wondering what might have been. After the death of St. Teresa, there was something of a power struggle among the Discalced Carmelites, and John found himself on the outside looking in at the leadership of the order, and he found himself in disfavor. At the same time, he found himself becoming seriously ill. And while he was ill, he was exiled to one of the poorest and smallest of the monasteries of the order. And while he was ill, one of his opponents was going from Carmelite monastery to Carmelite monastery, trying to gain information that they would use to expel John from the order. Well, this never came to pass, because he just got sicker. And he was sent to the monastery at Ubeda, where he was not treated very well. They did not seem to be very happy with him coming there. But he was fading, and while this was happening, everyone seemed to notice the holiness of the man. And with his passing, actually, it was met with a great deal of reverence and enthusiasm. Even his adversaries came to appreciate the holiness of the man. His body has remained incorrupt. Many people notice the appearance of the images of Christ on the cross, the Blessed Virgin, or other saints in the relic of St. John of the Cross, and he was canonized in 1726. Thank you for listening, and we'll be back again soon with another installment.
Wanna do it funky now. Talking about that funky Malaguena now.